Hello everyone, in this video we are going to discuss on the modern tree unit 1, because we have started the modern tree at the initial because it's a combination of power electronics also and also the instrumentation part. So what I have done, I have finished off the lecture 1 with the modern tree unit 3 then. So here I am going to conclude here with the inverters and the SMPS in the modern tree. So here in this video we are going to discuss mainly about the basic classification of the inverters and what are the half wave bridge inverters. So we will be discussing only about the half wave bridge inverter. In the next video we will be discussing about the full wave bridge inverter. So first, brief introduction about inverters. What is meant by inverters? It is nothing but DC to AC conversion is nothing but we call it as an inverters. Actually, inverter is a circuit that converts DC power to AC power at a desired output voltage and frequencies. Usually, we have seen in a household or any of the, for example, the of hospitals and all. Usually, they have this inverters, the high voltage, usually high power inverters in the airports and the hospital. In the home we have usually about 320 volts and all this means we can have, because we in home we don't require almost that much power there. Usually that is nothing but the inverter circuit. What it is doing that, from whenever we have a power in the homes, it is storing the energy that the AC whatever is there, it is converting to the DC and it is storing in the form of a battery. Whenever the power goes, or when they don't have a power supply from the whatever the boards we have, electricity boards, so that time this circuit again turn on, and till the power supply is there it is in the idle state. Idle state means it is getting charged. When the power supply is gone and it is not given any kind of a power supply to the house also, that time this type of circuit will initiate. So that time again it will convert DC whatever stored in the battery, it's converted to given to the circuit what is there, that we call inverter circuit, that will convert DC to AC there. This AC output voltage obtained could be a fixed variable or any kind of a variable frequency. The output frequency is determined by the rate at which the semiconductor devices turn on and off. That is, what is the rate we design it in the inverter circuit, that is whatever the device we are using there. So it will determine what is this duty cycle, and duty cycle in turn is nothing but on and off cycle. The DC power out can be cell battery, solar cells or fuel cells. First, the brief introduction of the classification of the inverters. So first, classification according to the nature of the input source. First one is the voltage source inverters. The voltage source inverter has a stiff DC source voltage, that is the DC voltage has limited or zero impedance at the inverter input level. So that much only the input can be converted there. Then next about the current source inverters. Current source inverter is supplied with a variable current from a DC source that has high impedance. That is, resulting current waves are not influenced by the load. So what it is trying to say, that it is the high impedance has been given to the source, that is, that's not affecting any kind of a load to it. The classification according to the wave shape of the output voltage. So what is here? The square wave inverter, that is what a square wave inverter produces a square wave AC voltage of a constant magnitude, and the output voltage can be varied by controlling the input DC voltage. It is used for low and medium power application. It is used for low and medium power application. So what is there? The output, whatever is there, is we are getting in the terms of a square wave. So that is what is controlled by using the DC input, DC voltage. Next one is the quasi square wave inverter. What is this quasi square wave inverter? It's just trying to generate a waveform almost near to sine wave. It is not cannot generate a smooth sine wave. A modified sine wave inverter creates some pauses before phase shifting. So it will have some kind of a variation in the phase shift of sine wave. It is not generating exactly at 0 degree the repeating cycles. So it might sometimes for 90 degrees, sometimes 180 degrees, some more 120, something which like different we can have in the phase shift. It doesn't shift phase directly from positive to negative like a square. So that again activation will be. The pulse width modulated inverter. It uses a switching scheme within the inverters to modify the shape of the output voltage waveform. So it can vary the width, that's what we are generating. The width can be generated using the switching scheme then. So when how much duration it has to made on, that much is kept. How much the duration has to made off, that much is been left. So that we have to be designed. Okay. Next one, classification. The thyristor inverter classification. According to this kind of a classification, we have two types according to the method of commutation. That is the line commutated inverters. One type. In case of AC circuits, the AC line voltage is available across the device. When the current in the SCR goes through a natural zero, the device is turned off. That is what we call as a. When we have a positive half cycle, the SCRs or the thyristor will conduct. But when we go for a negative half cycle, it will provide a natural commutation to those things. Because it's passing through the zero, right? It's having a negative half cycle in a negative. So that time it will get you that state. The force commutated inverter. Here, the supply doesn't go to the zero point. Some external force has to be required to commutate the device. So here, SCR has to be given an external source to provide that negative or that reverse voltage to make it off. So this kind of thing we call it as a force commutator. Usually these are used for the DC and this is usually obtained in the AC line commutator. Another type of the connections that what we are finished in the classification we do, series, parallel and bridge. Okay. And in the bridge, half bridge inverters and full bridge inverters. So here half bridge inverter and full bridge inverter. So you know what I mean by half bridge and full bridge. So we have detailed study about this half bridge and full bridge inverter. Okay. In the next slide we'll be starting with the half bridge inverter, but in the next video we'll discuss about the full bridge inverter. One basic thing what we need to study is that if you understand the half bridge inverter properly, the full bridge inverter is easy to analyze. So now, what I mean by single phase half bridge voltage source inverter? This is an inverter that device converts a DC voltage into an AC voltage and it consists of four switches. Whereas half bridge inverter requires two diodes and two switches which are connected in anti-parallel. We'll look into the circuit and we'll analyze. The two switches are complementary switches, which means when one first switch is on, the second switch will be off. Similarly, when the second switch is on, the first switch will be on. We can look it here. We have two diodes here and two switch here. Okay. The switch S1 and S2 are the gate commutated switches such as BJT, IGBT, and when the close the switches conduct. Usually, this loads here. This load is what is resistive load. And that is R is equals to load is what is R. We don't have any kind of inductor to this. So when this close the switches and conduct goes through it, the load is directly. We have mentioned it through the arrow. In this figure, S1 and S2 are self-commutating switches. That is, S1 the switch S1 will conduct, and the voltage is positive, and current is negative. because you can observe it here in the inverter circuit. This is positive and this is negative. This is as invert as the what we use as the convention. And this, what is this happening here? When the positive, when the switch rod will conduct, the current will, the voltage will find positive. And this will conduct here, and when the voltage is positive here, and the current is negative, this is what we are doing here. And this will conduct when the voltage is negative and current is negative. So here D1 will conduct when the voltage is positive and current is negative, and D2 will conduct when the voltage is negative and current is negative. We need not worry about too much about this D here. So what is happening now, we can see when the switch S1 is conducting from 0 to 1, that is T/2, you can see it here. This is what the output what we are getting here. So when switch 1 is closed during the first period of this IC output, it's point P. That connects point P of the DC source to point A. When the output voltage E0 becomes equal to the EDC by 2. When switch S1 is on, from a time period of 0 to T by 2, the diode D1 and D2 are in reverse bias condition and switch S2 is on. When period 2, when switch S2 is conducting from T by 2 to T, that is T is equals to, where T is equals to 1 by R, the gating signal is been removed from S1 and it is terminal. For the next half period, the gating signal is given to S2. It connects points N of the DC source point to A, and the output voltage reverses. Thus, by closing S1 and S2 alternative for half period of time, a square wave AC voltage is being obtained at the output. When switch S2 is on, from a period of T to T, the D1 and D2 are in reverse bias condition, and switch S1 is on. So D1 and D2 doesn't have any role here. So what is happening? The S1 positive half will give, and then the S2 switch will give the negative. So we'll consider with respect to the RL load. Here we have an individual circuit to it. The same circuit, but the load is being connected with respect to the inductor edge. The operation of the half bridge inverter with RL load. Here, the presence of the inductor doesn't allow the load current to change immediately with the output voltage. The diode acts like a feedback diode. What is the, here we have different modes here. We can see here, mode 1. Here, S1 is turned on. Instant T1, the load voltage is equal to the EDC/2. So whatever you are given here, it is given to the S2. The positive current increases gradually here. At the instant T2, the load current reaches peak value. The switch S1 is turned off at this juncture. When it is reached to the peak value, it has been reached. Due to the same polarity of the load voltage and the load current, the energy is stored by the load. Energy is being stored by the load because the inductor is being permitted. Next, in the mode 2, due to the inductive load, the load direction, current direction will be maintained even after S1 is turned. The self-induced voltage will be negative because we have given provided with the negative. The load through the lower half supply, that entity D2, are given here. In this mode, the stored energy in the load is feedback to the lower half of the source, and the load voltage is clamped to minus EDC/2. Next, in the mode 3 here, this is regarding the switch S2. At this instant, the T3, the load current goes to zero, indicating that the energy stored has been returned back to the lower half supply of the. At this instant, T3, S2 is turned on. This will produce a negative load voltage E0 is equal to minus EDC by 2 and a negative load current, and this load current reaches a negative peak at this interval of time. You can see it. The negative load current will be in this time, the voltage out is there, it will reach. So what we are getting the load is the minus EDC by 2. At the mode 4, the switch 2 is turned off at this time. The self-induced voltage in the inductor load will maintain the load current. The load voltage changes in the polarity to become the positive EDC by 2. The load current remains negative and the stored energy in the return load is returned back to the upper half of the DC source. So that time at instant T5, the load current goes to zero and switch S1, that is, can be turned on again. This cycle of operation repeats both the cases. You can see it here. This is ADC by 2, ADC by 2. What is happening here? This instant, you can see it. From T1, it will reach to here, the current. Then till T2 to T3, it will reach here. When we have, this is mode 1 and this is mode 2. When it is going to the mode 3, it will reach like this. Then it is reached to the peak level and it is trying to attain the positive level. So mode 1, mode 2, mode 3, mode 2. Like this it will go. So S1 is on here, switch 1 is on here, D2 will be on here, S2 is on here, D1 is on. That is the this part. So this is what we need to. Here, one problem is that is the cross conduction of the shoot through wall. In a bridge, half bridge, each switch can act for a period of T/T seconds. At a particular instant, one switch is turned on, another switch is off. However, the outgoing switch does not turn off instantaneously due to its infinite turn off delay. Due to this, both the switches can act simultaneously for a short time. This is known as cross conduction or a shoot through default. It can be avoided by allowing the outgoing switch to turn off completely first and then applying the gate drive to incoming device. This can be done by introducing a dead band or a delay between the trailing edge of the base drive of the outgoing device and leading edge of the base drive of the incoming device. That is, we have to have a delay between the mode 1 and mode 2, mode 2 and mode 3, and mode 3 and mode 4. Also, it has to be seen to it that S1 is completely off to make S2 on. Or S2 has to completely off that I have to make S1 on. Else, whatever is happening, it will get mixed up and whatever the voltage will be having a lot of distortion. And that might affect the whatever the devices we are using. These are the references which I referred it for. Halfway bridge rectifier, the inverters here, MD Singh in KB Kanchandani. The other two are the references. Thank you.